Hey there, y'all. Real Kit Kitty here. Yet again, we're back with Stanley Parable and picking up where I left off. And honestly, that last set of results, which will be linked at the end of the video, were crazy. I'm pretty sure I've been breaking this game in the wrong order or something, because I'm definitely getting way too messed up too fast. But we're gonna go ahead and keep going and see what happens and pursue another couple pathways of answers, I guess. If the loading screen will ever work. Well, not work, but there we go.
This is the story of our...
We're gonna skip the Stanley thing intro, because I've heard that before. And what I'm going to do here is just kind of jump around until I get to places and things that are new. So hopefully it won't take too terribly long.
Wave of disbelief, Stanley decided
Ooh,
to go
out
to his boss's office, hoping he might find an answer there. Stanley stepped into the broom closet, but there was nothing here, so he turned around and got back on track.
Aw, I thought there was something.
There was nothing here. No choice to make, no path to follow, just an empty broom closet. No reason to still be here.
We're gonna sit here a few minutes and see if anything will happen.
It was baffling that Stanley was still just sitting in the broom closet. He wasn't even doing anything. At least if there was something to interact with, he'd be justified in some way. As it is, he's literally just standing there doing sweet F.A. Are you really still in the broom closet? Standing around doing nothing? Why? Please offer me some explanation here. I'm genuinely confused.
Apparently I really can't interact with anything. Huh.
You do realize there's no choice or anything in here, right? If I'd said Stanley walked past the broom closet, at least you would have had a reason for exploring it to find out.
Maybe he'll get frustrated.
Because literally, this closet is of absolutely no significance to the story whatsoever. I never would have thought to mention it.
I'm just waiting for him to get frustrated and give me a new option.
Maybe to you, this is somehow its own branching path. Maybe when you go talk about this with your friend, you'll say, "Oh, did you get the broom closet ending? The broom closet ending was my favorite." I hope your friends find this concerning.
That's a hideous font color.
Stanley was fat and ugly and really, really stupid. He probably only got the job because of a family connection. That's how stupid he is. That or with drug money. Also, Stanley is addicted to drugs and hookers.
You'd be as mean to me as you wanna. I am staying right here until you get mad.
Well, I've come to a very definite conclusion about what's going on right now. You're dead. You got to this broom closet, explored it a bit, and were just about to leave because there's nothing here, when a physical malady of some sort shut down your central nervous system and you collapsed on the keyboard. Well, in a situation like this, the responsible thing is to alert someone nearby so as to ensure that your body is taken care of before it begins to decompose. Hello? Anyone who happens to be nearby? The person at this computer is dead. He or she has fallen prey to any number of your countless human physiological vulnerabilities. It's indicative of the long-term sustainability of your species. Please remove their corpse from the area and instruct another human to take their place at the computer, making sure they understand basic first-person video game mechanics and filling them in on the history of narrative tropes in video gaming, so that the irony and insightful commentary of this game is not lost on them. Right. When you've done that, just step out into the hallway.
That's not how that works.
Second player, it's good to have you on board. I guarantee you can't do any worse than the person who came before you.
Watch me.
You too. Unbelievable. I'm at the mercy of an entire species of invalids.
Rude.
Perhaps there's a monkey nearby you can hand the control. animals too. The fish, fungus. Look, you can hammer out the details. I'm not particularly picky. I'll just be waiting for when you're ready to pick up the story again.
I wonder how many times I can do this.
Okay, I got this. Let's do this.
No, nothing. Still can't.
Still can't interact with anything. That doesn't work. Nothing. Okay.
Okay. Well, I guess that's that. Dang. I really wish there was a run function.
Coming to a staircase, Stanley walked upstairs to his boss's office.
See what's down here. Oh, red light. That's not good. Oh, it's nothing. It's literally nothing. Fire hose. What?
But Stanley just couldn't do it. He considered the possibility of facing his boss, admitting he had left his post during work hours. He might be fired for that. And in such a competitive economy, why had he taken that risk? All because he believed everyone had vanished. His boss would think he was crazy. And then something occurred to Stanley. Maybe, he thought to himself, maybe I am crazy. All of my co-workers blinking mysteriously out of existence in a single moment for no reason at all? None of it made any logical sense. And as Stanley pondered this, he began to make other strange observations. For example, why couldn't he see his feet when he looked down? Why did doors close automatically behind him wherever he went? And for that matter, these rooms were starting to look pretty familiar. Were they simply repeating? No, Stanley said to himself, this is all too strange. This can't be real. And at last, he came to the conclusion that had been on the tip of his tongue. He just hadn't found the words for it. I'm dreaming, he yelled. This is all a dream.
What?
Oh, what a relief Stanley felt to have finally found an answer, an explanation. His co-workers weren't actually gone. He wasn't going to lose his job. He wasn't crazy after all. And he thought to himself, I suppose I'll wake up soon. I'll have to go back to my boring real-life job pushing buttons. I may as well enjoy this while I'm still lucid. So, he imagined himself flying. And began to gently float.
No, the ground. No.
Then he imagined himself soaring through space on a magical star field, and it too appeared.
Oh, God.
It was so much fun, and Stanley marveled that he had still not woken up. How was he remaining so lucid? Perhaps the strangest question of them all entered Stanley's head. One he was amazed he hadn't asked himself sooner. Why is there a voice in my head dictating everything that I'm doing and thinking? Now the voice was describing itself being considered by Stanley, who found it particularly strange. I'm dreaming about a voice describing me, thinking about how it's describing my thoughts, he thought. And while he thought it all very odd and wondered if this voice spoke to all people in their dreams, the truth was that, of course, this was not a dream. How could it be? Was Stanley simply deceiving himself, believing that if he's asleep, he doesn't have to take responsibility for himself? Stanley is as awake right now as he's ever been in his life. Now, hearing the voice speak these words was quite a shock to Stanley. After all, he knew for certain, beyond a doubt, that this was in fact a dream. Did the voice not see him float and make the magical stars just a moment ago? How else would the voice explain all that? This voice was a part of himself too. Surely, if he could just... He would prove it. He would prove that he was in control, that this was a dream. So he closed his eyes gently, and he invited himself...
No.
He weighted the blanket on his skin, the press of the mattress on his back. The fresh air of a world outside this one. Let me wake up, he thought to himself. I'm through with this dream. I wish it to be over. Let me go back to my job. Let me continue pushing the buttons. Please, it's all I want.
You can't make me do anything.
And my wife and my job.
I have a wife.
All I want is my life exactly the way it's always been. My life is normal. I am normal. Everything will be fine. I am okay.
I can't let you do that, Stanley. I know this. What the heck?
Stanley began screaming.
Please, someone, wake me up. My name is Stanley. I have a boss. I have an office. I am real. Please, just someone tell me I am real. I must be real. I must be. Can anyone hear my voice? Who am I? Who am I?
And everything went black.
What? Come on. Twice.
This is the story of a woman named Mariella.
What?
Mariella woke up on a day like any other. She arose, got dressed, gathered her belongings, and walked to her place of work. But on this particular day, her walk was interrupted by the body of a man who had stumbled through town talking and screaming to himself, and then collapsed dead on the sidewalk. And although she would soon turn to go call for an ambulance, for just a few brief moments, she considered the strange man. He was obviously crazy. This much she knew. Everyone knows what crazy people look like. And in that moment, she thought to herself how lucky she was to be normal. I am sane. I am in control of my mind. I know what is real and what isn't. It was comforting to think this, and in a certain way, seeing this man made her feel better. But then she remembered the meeting she had scheduled for that day. The very important people whose impressions of her would affect her career, and by extension, the rest of her life. She had no time for this, so it was only a moment that she stood there, staring down at the body. And then she turned and ran.
Let me just stand here and look at this guy who just collapsed after screaming and running around town. I'm not going to call an ambulance or anything. I'm just going to stare at him and contemplate the fact that I am, in fact, normal.
Okay, and that's the end of this episode. So if you liked this video, like, comment, and subscribe. Don't forget to share with everyone. Click that bell for notifications. There will be a link to the other videos in this playlist at the end. And I will see y'all in the next one. Kit Kitty out.